Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadada Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Jaya Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Jaya Prabhupada. Nittai Gaura Haribol, Haribol. Hari bol Nitai Gaur Hari bol
Jai Om Vishnupada Paramahamsa Parivrajaka Acharya Ashtodhara Shri His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Jai Om Vishnupada Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Ashtotathar Shri. His Divine Grace Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Se Kaho Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shyamakunda Radha Kunda Giriraj Govardhan Ki Jai. Ganga Mai Yamuna Mai Ki Jai. Bhakti Devi Tulasi Devi Ki Jai. Navadvip Mayapur Dham Ki Jai. Purushottam Kshetra Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jai. Nithai Gaura Premanande. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam Tato Jayamudirayet Nashtaprayeshva Badreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavatir Uttamashloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya cha Nandagopakumaraya Govindaya Namo Namaha. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuronmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Tadati Swapadantikam. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raguna Tanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha. He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripasindubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna. So I would like to welcome all of you for the Sunday Feast program, especially after having a hectic day, hectic week throughout the week. Sunday is a day to take rest and make up for the rest. But I'm very grateful to all of you for taking your valuable time to come for the satsang here. So today I shall try to discuss something on the topic of relationships from the Shastra, from the Mahabharata, Ramayana and the Srimad Bhagavatam. We'll take some examples from the lives of the Pandavas on the topic of the family and relationships. So there was one student, he came from the Western world on a tour to India. And when he came to India, he made an observation that the infrastructure in India is very incoherent. Some big houses, some small houses, houses with the different colors. Sometimes the roads are narrow. So he saw that the infrastructure was it's not proper. The buildings are not orderly, not made in a proper order. And the design of one building is different from another building. Generally, in the Western world, the buildings are like, they're very orderly, and then like in a particular community, the buildings are of, at least externally, they're of the same design. They're very coherently built. But so this person, when he came to India, he saw that in India the roads and the buildings are not orderly, they are not made in an orderly manner. And then the student said, but although the infrastructure in India is not proper, but the Indian homes are coherent from within. That means there are cordial relationships within the home, and the inner families are built nicely, although the external homes may not be, they may not have a proper infrastructure, the roads may not have a proper infrastructure. But within the house, people are staying together in a family. But on the other hand, in the Western world, the infrastructure is much, much better compared to India. But the inner structure within those homes, those families are broken. The parents are not staying together, or the kids are in their own world. So therefore, this is one of the difference between civilization based on spirit and a civilization based on matter. This is one of the difference between the Vedic civilization and the non-Vedic culture. So in the non-Vedic culture, although I may use the word Western civilization, but it means like where non-Vedic values are followed. It can be within India also, or it can be outside India also. So in the non-Vedic civilization, the external infrastructure is good, but the inner structure is broken from within. But in India, the external infrastructure may be improper, but the inner structure is not broken, although it is also catching up with the West. But compared to the West, inner structure is much more stable. So therefore,
when we talk about the leadership, the Vedic leadership, it talks about the coordination between the inner infrastructure and the outer infrastructure. So when we neglect either of them, it will lead to a conflict. Like in a proper any system, like there has to be inner infrastructure should be proper. That means the family systems should be stable. And this inner infrastructure is taken care of by decentralized leaders. Decentralized leaders are the leaders in a particular family. The father, mother, husband, wife. The decentralized leaders can refer to the teachers, the village heads. So the inner infrastructure is taken care of by decentralized leaders, and the outer infrastructure is taken care of by the leaders like the kings or the head of the government. So therefore, in a proper system, when the individual strength increases, it helps in the growth of the collective strength. And when the collective strength increases, and it helps in the growth of the weak individual. So therefore, that both of them, both the decentralized leaders, for the local leaders, leaders in a particular family or in a small, say, community or village leaders, they also play a crucial role. And the centralized leaders, they also play a crucial role in strengthening the inner infrastructure and the outer infrastructure. So therefore, like I saw recently, there was a video which was circulated in the WhatsApp. It talked about how in Japan is one of the most technologically advanced countries in terms of infrastructure and the advanced electronic gadgets. And in Japan, they have the concept of rental families. That means that they rent a family member. They rent a person, there are particular companies or something who offer certain people who can act as a father or as a mother or as a friend for certain number of hours or certain days or something like that. So they have the concept of rental families. So we can see that the families are, the inner structure is so broken from within, and they, because ultimately every living entity is looking for the innate nature of every living entity is actually he wants to love and he wants to be loved. And there is so much of external progress, but then the inner structure is so broken that they actually rent people who will act as a family member. Although they may speak very nicely, politely for a certain number of hours, ultimately there is a money involved. It is just only for it's like a plastic smile. So we can see that this one of the reason why the families, the inner structure, the families break is that one of the important factor is the reverence towards the elders, the respect towards the elders, this attitude start decreasing. In fact, Chanakya Pandit talks about, he gives a definition of a learned person. He says that Matruvat Paradareshu Paradravyeshu Loshravat Atmavat Sarvabhuteshu Yapashyati Sapanditaha.
He says that one who considers other women to be like a mother, except one's wife, and one who respects others as one would want himself to be respected, and one who considers others' property to be like a stone, he is considered to be a learned person. So here, like one of the point mentioned in this verse is that the attitude of respecting others. So this culture of respect is actually is one of the important point in the any civilized culture, in the Vedic civilization. In one place in the Srimad Bhagavatam, when there is a description of the fight between Varahadev and Hiranyaksha, so at a particular point that Varahadev's weapon, it fell down. So in the description, there is an analogy which is given. The analogy says that previously there was a fight between Indra and Garuda. So Garuda was actually snatching a pot of nectar and going away. At that time, Indra actually was fighting with Garuda. So that time, Indra hurled a thunderbolt weapon upon Garuda. Although Garuda was actually invincible, he was very powerful, but in order to respect the thunderbolt weapon, he voluntarily gave up one of his wings. Although he had the power to withstand the thunderbolt weapon, but still he voluntarily gave up his wings as a respect towards the, as a mark of respect towards the Vajra, because that Vajra was made from the bones of the Adichi Muni, and the Adichi Muni's bones represent the power of the holy names. Because Adichi Muni, he attained so much of power because of chanting the Narayana Kavacha Mantra. So as a mark of respect, Garuda actually voluntarily gave up one of his wings. And Prabhupada writes in the purport, we can see that in this incident, that even in a fight, even in the act of fighting, that there is a culture of respect towards the other party. So therefore, this culture of respect is something which Chanakya Pandit emphasizes in this verse, Atmavat Sarva Bhuteshu. So we see that in any ancient tradition, any civilized cultures, there is a culture of respect towards the father and the mother and the elders. There is a professor who was a dean of a Texas university. He wrote a book called as Reverence. Reverence, renewing a forgotten virtue. And in that book he writes that that American culture or the non-Vedic cultures, they celebrate irreverence. They celebrate not having a reverential or respectful attitude towards the elders. And many modern economic theories and many modern economic thinkers, they say that those communities which have an irreverent attitude, they will be able to achieve high economic growth. And they say that those cultures who have a reverential attitude towards the elders, and they will actually progress slowly in the economic domain. And these modern thinkers, they counsel the slow growing nations, if you want to become economic superpower, then you have to promote the attitude of irreverence. This culture of respect towards the elders, that will actually act as a hindrance for your economic growth. So this particular view is the view of the modern thinkers. And
like this kind of attitude also becomes the foundation of modern economics, which is based on individualistic culture. If you see in the one of the Western culture is one of the characteristics of the Western culture is it is a highly individualistic society. Whereas the Vedic culture is a family-centric society. It's a family-centric society. So when we talk about one of the things which give foundation to the family-centric society is the attitude of reverence, attitude of respect. And the family-centric society, the foundation of that is actually the attitude of performing one's duty, the attitude of giving value to the relationships. But whereas the Western culture, it underplays duty. In the Western culture, what is given importance is the rights over the duty. They talk about gender rights, the rights of the elders, children rights, the rights of the transgenders, like that. They talk about rights in all levels. But whereas the family-centered society, it rests upon duty. Just few statistics about the Western culture, which is actually based on individualistic society. It is said that in the US alone, 55% of the first marriages, 67% of the second marriages, and 74% of the third marriages end in divorce. So like that, there are many statistics are there. But there is one interesting point, this Paul Woodruff, he actually makes when he is analyzing about the family-centric society versus the individualistic West. So he analyzes based on two criteria, savings and social security. Because according to the modern economic thinkers, they say that if you give up reverence, then you can progress faster economically. Reverence is like an obstacle for your growth. So he analyzes the two societies based on savings and social security. He says that the family-centric Asian societies account for 3/4 of the global savings. But the individualistic Western society, it borrows almost the equal amount from the world. Because the families are practically broken, so they don't feel the need to save for the somebody else. So the family share was 4/5 of the total US savings in the 1960s. The 1960s, when the family culture was still intact in the US, then the savings was 4/5. But now the amount which they borrow as a debt is much more than what they save. So because the reason is that because the inner structure, the families are broken, so therefore the amount they save is practically nil. It goes into negative. In fact, it is said that some 11 crore US families use 120 credit and debit cards, and their total borrowings actually exceed, that is dollar 12 trillion against the current US GDP of 16 trillion. In fact, in the Mahabharata, when there is an episode of Yaksha Prashna,
there was a conversation between Maharaj Yudhishthir and Yaksha. So the other four Pandavas, when they were going to drink some water in a lake, and then they heard a voice that you should not drink this water from the lake. If you drink not following my instruction, then you will actually immediately become, you will immediately die. The other four Pandavas, they became unconscious. When Yudhishthira Maharaj came, he was very thirsty, but in that thirsty condition, he had to, the Yaksha said that, first you answer my questions before drinking the water, otherwise you will get the same condition like the other, like your other brothers. So Yudhishthira Maharaj started answering the questions. So this is called as a real examination. Like normally we are used to an examination where the date is announced, the syllabus is known, sometimes the set of questions are known, and then you just have to like maybe memorize those questions. Like we have that kind of a system, even you know spiritual institutions are this one, we have that kind of a system. Like these, yeah, it is, at least if people get to read, they have to go through some books, they go through that. But it is not, in a sense, a foolproof system, because one is just tested for, one just memorizes something and then writes exam, somehow gets some degree or something, and then later one never opens the book. So, but the real examination is that they come in the real life situations where you are tested for your understanding and where you are tested for the application of the principles. So here, Yudhishthira Maharaj, like he was completely thirsty and he was so tired. And at that time, he had to answer so many questions. And this Yaksha asked something like 124 questions, something like more than 100 questions he asked. And in that condition, having a right presence of mind, Yudhishthira Maharaj answered all the questions satisfactorily. And that finally, Yaksha said that you answer four questions. If you answer these four questions, and that is the end of the question answer session, and then I'll give you a benediction. So one of the questions he asked was that who is a happy person? So here, Yudhishthira Maharaj was Dharma personified. He knows all the secrets of Dharma, but he gives a very practical answer to this question. Like sometimes, somebody is highly learned, but when they speak or when they, like, the other people cannot connect. But here Yudhishthira Maharaj gave a very practical answer. He said, a happy person is one who does not have debts, and one who gets hot food cooked at home, and who does not have to travel long for work. Anyway, this particular point, here Yudhishthira Maharaj says that one of the happy person is one who does not have debts. So when we see this, connecting with this statistics, so the individualistic society, which is the Western culture, there they have more debt than what they save, than what they spend. So how can the society or culture in which has the foundation of borrowing more, the foundation itself is wrong. How can they be actually happy? How can they be happy? So this is in this way he analyzes the family-centric Asian society versus the Western society based on the savings. And the second criteria is based on social security. So that in the Western societies, when the family is disintegrated, the care of the parents and the elders the responsibility to take care of the elders that fell on the society, that fell on the government. And then the government, they started the social security schemes. And some thinkers, they say that, see, our society is so advanced that we have social security schemes, but in India and all, you don't have social security schemes. Sometimes certain modern thinkers, they may criticize. But the actual fact is that the present value of the future social security burden for the US is estimated at over $100 trillion, more than the 6 times the present GDP. And this is seen as a dynamite of the US economy, that any time because of that the economy can collapse. So we see that one of the person, he mentioned that the American society, they are actually desperately looking for some opportunity to stop the social security scheme because it is becoming a huge burden on the government. But then you cannot stop it overnight. Previously, the taking care of the elders, that was taken care of by the younger people in the family. Now the family system has completely collapsed. So now to take back the social security scheme, that means that you have to reinstate the family system. But that cannot be done overnight. It cannot be done overnight. The values have actually degraded like anything. So therefore, that we can see that on the other hand, the family-centric Asian societies are especially the Vedic culture, the social security is actually privatized. Privatized means it is actually the individual families, they take care of the elders. So the government does not have that burden. And what actually gives the impetus for the individual families to take care of the elders? That is the principle of reverence, the principle of gratitude and respect for the elders. And that is what actually Chanakya Pandit mentions in that verse, that respecting others. So therefore, this it is not that the culture of actually reverence and respect, it's not some sentimental principle or it is some old tradition. It has a practical economic benefit. When we analyze the economic status of the Western countries and the economic status of the family-centric, say, India or where the culture is there. So, if we see that this episode, this culture of the family, there's one episode in the Mahabharata in which we can actually see how the people in a how the responsible members of the family, how they interact, how there is a spirit of sacrifice. So there's a beautiful episode which comes in the Mahabharata. So the Pandavas were, the Kauravas, they tried to actually kill the Pandavas by actually inviting them to the house of Lakh. And they burnt that house of Lakh and they thought that the Pandavas had died, but the Pandavas, they actually escaped from that house of Lakh because of the hints given by Vidura. And the Pandavas were wandering from one place to another place. And then they came to a particular place called as Ekachakra. Ekachakra is also the the birthplace of Nityananda Prabhu. We celebrated Nityananda Trayodashi appearance day a few days back.
And they came to Ekachakra. The Pandava, one Brahmin family, they offered him, the Pandavas, some shelter. The Pandavas stayed at the house of this Brahmin family. So every day, the Pandavas would go to actually beg for some alms. And then whatever they would get, one part would be given for Bhima, the other part would be divided by the other members. So one day, so Bhima had stayed back. So Bhima and Kunti were there in the house. And the other Pandavas had gone. And suddenly, Kunti heard a loud noise in the house. Somebody crying. So immediately Kunti told Bhima that it seems the members, our hosts who are hosting us, they are in some great difficulty. We should try to help them. And Kunti said that he is truly a man who pays back the benefit received. When we receive some help from others, one should do more good, one should do more in return than what we have received. There was one person who asked Vishveshatirtha Pejavar Math Swami, who disappeared from this world a few months back. He asked a question that, what is the, how should a person in the renounced order behave? In fact, although the question may be like that, but the answer is applicable for everyone. So when he asked that question, Pejavar Swami Maharaj mentioned that one should act in such a way that our contribution to the society is more than what we have received from the society. So if this should be the attitude of every person in the society, when we think that I should contribute more than what we have received, then that will lead to actually a more deeper satisfaction, that will lead to a more stable society. So, just like this Kunti is telling that we have received some help from this Brahmanas, we should do more help to them than what we have received. Normally, one of the Western concept, they talk about the needs more. My physical needs, emotional needs, mental needs. Yeah, we have our needs. But the Vedic mindset or Vedic culture is that one talks more about the responsibilities than about one's own needs. Have I fulfilled the responsibility? Have I fulfilled the responsibility to the society or the family and the other people? So the Vedic mindset is that one thinks in terms of more about responsibility than about one's own needs. And the Isopanishad purport, Prabhupada says that human life is a life of responsibility. Kunti tells to Bhima, let us find out actually what is their difficulty. And then they go and actually hear the conversation, the Brahmin's family. The Brahmanas, that family, they are not aware that Kunti and Bhima are actually overhearing the conversation. So at that time, the Brahmanas started conversing, and the conversation, from that actually we can understand, we can get a glimpse of how those people who are conscious of the responsibility, how they actually converse, what is their thought process. We can get a glimpse of their understanding from the conversation. So that Brahmana starts speaking that a great distress has come upon me. That a great distress has come upon me.
I don't know how to behave, like what to do in this condition. Like what was happening is that there was an asura called as Bakasura was living in the outskirts of the village, and he was a man-eating asura. So he had put a condition, like previously he was killing the people, and he was eating all kinds of eatables and killing the human beings indiscriminately. And then the villagers, they put a condition, do not do like that. And they put a mutual agreement, once in a month or once in fortnightly, we will supply the amount of foodstuffs you need, and also one person will also come along with the foodstuffs. You can eat all those foodstuffs, and I can also eat that person. So we will actually, one by one from different family, and there will be a turn, and then different families will get a turn to supply those foodstuffs and also sacrifice one of the family members. That is how the villagers, they made an agreement. So that particular turn came for this particular family. They had to supply the foodstuffs, and they had to send one member of the family to be eaten by this asura. So this Brahmana was saying that I don't know what to do in this situation, that should I sacrifice myself or should I send any one of you? I cannot sacrifice any one of you because you are all kept under my protection. I cannot sacrifice, the Brahmana was telling to his wife that I cannot sacrifice you. It is my responsibility to take care of you. And I cannot send my son or my daughter. And if I sacrifice myself, then the thought of sacrificing me, like, that is so painful that if I sacrifice myself, when I think that how would you be able to maintain yourself in the absence of me, that gives me so much of pain. In the sense, we can see this Brahmana, he is so conscious of his responsibility that he doesn't want to send any of the family members, he doesn't want to sacrifice any of the family members. At the same time, he feels that, okay, let me sacrifice myself. But then even in that, he is thinking that if I sacrifice myself, then how will the other family members, how will they be able to maintain themselves? So he is thinking about his responsibility of maintaining others. So there is a selfless spirit. He is so conscious of his responsibility. So because of that, he is in a complete confusion, he is in a complete distress. And he says here, he is telling to his wife, you were made by my parents as a partner of my domestic life. And you are nobly born and of good disposition. And you are a mother of a children. And you are ever devoted to me. And you are innocent. And you are ever constant to your vows. And you have chosen and wed me in due rites. How can I abandon you for the sake of saving my own life? And how shall I be able to abandon my son or my daughter, who has been given to me by the illustrious Creator for bestowing her on a husband and through whom I can please my ancestors? So in the Vedic culture, it is said that when a son is born, the son, by performing the Pindadana, the son actually saves the ancestors and the parents from gliding down to hell. And when the daughter is born, and the father gives the daughter in charity as a kanyadana, and by that he gets great piety that he can go to heaven. So, in both ways it is actually glorious, whether it is a son or a daughter. The son saves the ancestors from going to hell, and daughter actually helps the
father to go to heaven. So the Brahmana says that, but if I sacrifice myself and go to the other world, I shall still be repentant, because for being abandoned by me, my family members would not be able to live. How will they be able to protect themselves? So therefore, he was expressing his distress to his wife. At that time, and then the wife starts responding to the husband. And the wife says that let the object for which one desires a wife has already been achieved by you from me. A wife is supposed to give children, and I have already given you a daughter and a son, and by which I have been freed from the debt which I owe to you. So therefore, even if I am not there, you will be able to actually support and protect your children. But in the absence of you, I will not be able to properly take care of the children. Maybe some unscrupulous men will come and will ask for our daughter, and then I will be forced to give our daughter to some unscrupulous men. Some unqualified people will come and ask for our daughter, and then I will be forced to do that, and I will not be able to raise our son the way you can raise to please our ancestors. So it is better that I sacrifice myself, because I have also I have been freed from the debt, the purpose for which I have been given to you, that has been fulfilled. I have given the daughter and a son. Therefore, let me go along with that. Let me sacrifice myself. So here we see that here she also has a sacrificing spirit. And then at that time, when the father and mother, it's a detailed, long conversation, I'm just mentioning in short. And then when the father, the Brahmana and the wife, they are conversing, the daughter is also hearing that conversation. And the daughter comes and says, why are you so sorrowful? Why are you weeping? As if you have none. Please listen to my words. There is no doubt that you will one time abandon me by the dictates of virtue. At a particular point in time, you have to give me, you have to hand over to me to some other man. Like, the traditionally, a girl is called as a girl child is like when you grow the crops, like rice crops. Like, initially the rice crops are planted in a particular place, and then they grow to a particular stage, and then they remove that, and then they plant in the actual place. When the rainy season arrives, they remove it, and then they plant in the actual place. So initially the crop grows in a particular place, but it will be removed from that place, and then it will be planted elsewhere, and there it will grow properly. So a girl child is considered to be like that. I don't know what to say in Hindi or this one. This, in Tamil, it is called as Natru. Natru is the plantation which we do before planting in the original place. So a girl actually grows up in a particular family, but she gives prosperity in another family. So this girl is saying that, like, anyway, I will be handed over to somebody else. So there is no doubt that you will one time abandon me by the dictates of virtue. Therefore, please abandon me, who am anyway to be abandoned, and thus save all of you by sacrificing me alone. So, like, we can see the sacrificing spirit of the every member in the family. So the father, he is also in the sacrificing spirit, and the wife is also in the spirit of sacrifice, and the girl is also thinking that please sacrifice me, let me go, let me become a eatable for this asura, and then you all can actually live happily. And then she further says a beautiful point. She says that a child, a son, saves his parents in this world and in the next. A son is called as a putra because a son actually, by performing the pindadana, he saves the parents from going to hell, from gliding down to hell. So my brother, my younger brother, is have a very tender age. And suppose if either one of you go as a food for that asura, there is no doubt that my brother, in separation from you, will definitely die, because he is of a tender age. And having been abandoned by my father and my father and my mother, my brother will die. And then suppose if you are and then there will be nobody to actually offer the pindadan to our ancestors. Suppose if you actually go as a food to the asura, in separation from you, my brother will die. And then there is no son in our family to offer the pindadana to the ancestors. And then our ancestors will also glide down to hell. So it is better that my brother remains and let me sacrifice myself. So like that, she was giving a reasoning. So what we can see here is that the father, the Brahmana and his wife and the daughter all have a sacrificing spirit. So at that time, when they were all conversing with each other, at that time the small son comes. Like because he's a very small child, and he takes a small blade of grass, and in a smiling way he says that, "I will kill that asura. I will kill that asura easily with this blade of grass." And then he adds a little bit of humor in that difficult situation. And then suddenly they smile a little bit. So in this way the conversation was going on, and the Kunti and Bhima were actually hearing that conversation. So at that time, Kunti actually comes into the scene, and Kunti tells this Brahmana and his wife, "Please do not worry. I will send my son along with his footsteps, and he will actually take care of that asura. He has such a power that he will definitely kill that asura, and the whole village will be saved from the danger." So here we see, like, Kunti is one quality which we can see. Kunti raised the children with a great affection. But at the same time, Kunti had that faith in Bhima's power. And Kunti actually allowed Bhima to take that risk. Like sometimes in trying to show affection, one becomes overprotective. And because of that overprotective nature, one does not allow the children to take some risk. Because only when a person takes some risk, only when a person goes out of the comfort zone and takes some risk, then one will actually grow in his life. One will grow in his life. One will be able to, one will learn how to stand on one's own leg. If all the time, like if the parents are overprotective about the children, then the children will not actually grow in their life. They will become dependent. So Kunti, we can see that Kunti, she had raised the children with a great affection, but at the same time, she had confidence. That affection did not cover her confidence in Bhima. And she had full confidence in Bhima, and she allowed Bhima to take that risk. And then Bhima, of course, went with the footsteps. And when he went with the footsteps,
he ate all the footsteps in front of the asura, and the asura came to attack him. He just attacked that asura, he ate all the footsteps, and then he killed that asura very easily. And then in this way they came back, and then the Bhima came and said that, like, today, like, I was able to protect you from this asura, but then this is not a, like, you, all of you should actually develop, the village should actually develop their own system of protection, because you cannot be dependent on somebody from outside for actually protecting you. We were just wandering from one place to another place, we came here, and then we, I was able to protect you. Like, you should develop a self-sufficient system for protection. Like, there was a there was a school in Kolhapur. I forget the name of the school. I think Ekal. There's a name. In that school, they actually teach the different traditional techniques of protecting oneself. So the teacher, he was telling, he was giving an interesting statistic. He told that in Maharashtra alone, the number of policemen, the number of policemen for the common citizens, it is like for many, something like he mentioned, like, according to him, some 17,000 citizens, one policeman. Maybe there's a big number or something, but at least even if we take 4,000 for citizens, one policeman is there. So practically speaking, that, like, it's a very small number actually. A small number for protection. So the number of people in the police force are very small compared to the number of population. So that teacher was saying, therefore, we actually teach the common people, we teach the children, common people, about different methods of protecting themselves. Different martial arts and different, actually, ways of fighting. So therefore, the Bhima in one sense tell the same principle, that you have to develop, you have to become self-sufficient in your protection. So Bhima gave that advice, and then the Pandavas actually departed from that particular place. So this particular episode, we can learn from this episode that interaction between the family members who are conscious of the responsibility, how they have a spirit of sacrifice. So therefore, like His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj, he mentioned, he talks about five principles for building good relationships. Like, this is all, this is like, this discussion is also important in the sense that, like, this is the time where, like, there is a promotion of, like, Valentine's Day, like, all over the world. It is not a native to our culture, but the media actually bombards with these things. But in the Vedic culture, the concept of love is actually, it is not defined as an event to celebrate. It is not an event to celebrate on one day, whereas love is an act which is a display of full responsibility for the beloved. Therefore, that love and affection are actually investments for a whole lifetime, which will actually deepen our experience. It is not simply a single event to celebrate. It is something, it is coupled with a responsibility. When the love is coupled with a responsibility, then it gives a deeper experience with every passing year. So Radhanath Swami Maharaj mentions that five principles. The first principle, these five principles are important in any relationship, within a family or in a, say, in the brahmachari ashram, or we can say in a corporate or any. So first principle is that one should appreciate the past good of the other person. So that means one should remember whatever good that person has done, one should remember that with gratitude. In fact, the first canto Prabhupada says that one of the signs of intelligence is gratitude. one of the signs of intelligence is gratitude. Therefore, one should remember the good which other people have done. When Hanumanji was going across, crossing that ocean, the Samudra Raj reminded Mainak Parvat, long back you were saved from Indra by Vayudev. Vayu carried you when Indra was trying to destroy all the mountains. That time the Vayu actually carried you, and then Vayu actually put you in a safe place under the water. So that son of Vayu is actually going on a mission of Lord Ram. Why don't you show your gratitude towards Vayudev by serving Hanumanji? So therefore, memory is not about how many shlokas you remember. Memory is about remembering the good things which others have done to you. We may forget the, say, different shlokas or different verses. You may have written Bhakti Shastri, Bhakti Vaibha, you may forget those things. But we shouldn't forget the principle of gratitude. Therefore, appreciate the past good. And the second principle is that, recognize the potential of the other person and encourage that person to develop that potential. Again, we can see in the interaction between Jambavan and Hanuman. So Jambavan, when all the monkey soldiers were actually, they were faced with a dilemma of who will cross this ocean. Different monkey soldiers admitted their limitation. I can cross only 10 yojanas, I can cross 15 yojanas, I can cross only 30 yojanas, like that. And Hanumanji, he was sitting quietly. At that time, Jambavan came and reminded Hanumanji, you have the capacity to cross this ocean. Long back, you were actually cursed by the sages to forget your power. Therefore, you are not aware of your power. But you have the capacity to cross this ocean. Jambavan reminded his potential and encouraged him. So, Jambavan is like a hidden hero. There are many hidden heroes who don't come in the forefront, but they actually recognize the potential of others and they encourage them to actually use their potential. So this is an important principle in a relationship. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he himself wrote only 8 shlokas in the Shikshashtakam. But he actually inspired Rupa Goswami to write many books. He inspired Sanatan Goswami to write many books. He inspired Haridas Thakur to write Harinam Chintamani. He inspired Ramananda Rai to speak the Rasa Tattva. So this is an important thing, to recognize the potential of the other person and encourage that. So we can see, this is a second principle. And the third principle is that, respect the differences. There are differences between the different members in a family. So one should respect the differences in terms of, there will be differences in terms of the food habits or the, say, different preferences or taste or the opinions, the way of thinking. So one should actually respect the differences, because many times this principle is founded on the reality that everybody is unique in this world. Because one of the fundamental nature of this world is that there is a diversity in this world. Expecting the other people to be like us, that means we are trying to go against the fundamental characteristics of this world, which is trying to destroy diversity. So therefore, to create artificial uniformity is impossible. So one has to accept the difference and one has to respect the differences. And 4 plus 2 is also 6, 3 plus 3 is also 6. The same thing can be achieved through different this one. So, similarly, there are different ways of looking at the different things. So, this is the third principle. And the fourth principle is that one has to tolerate the unchangeable limitations. There are certain limitations in every person, and certain limitations cannot be changed. And we have to tolerate that. We have to tolerate that. And the more we actually try to change it or something, the situation will become more complicated. So one has to tolerate the unchangeable situations. We can see even in the Pandavas' lives that each of them had a different weakness. Bhima would act impulsively. And Arjuna would overthink. Yudhishthira Maharaj would also, many times he would be indecisive in nature. But yet they kindly tolerated their flaws and they achieved higher goals in their kinship. And the fifth principle is that one should forgive the accidental mistakes. There will be mistakes in every relationship and it should be forgiven. And sometimes in trying to forgive, one can develop a superiority complex. So, I am forgiving your mistake. So, one can indirectly develop a superiority complex. So, even better than forgiving is that one should take the mistake in a sportive manner. Means like, one shouldn't take that mistake also very seriously. So, it's all right. So, therefore, these five principles are important for a healthy relationship. And another important principle in a relationship is that all relationships in this world, except our relationship with Krishna, all relationships are actually seasonal. All relationships are actually seasonal. That means that just like the seasons keep changing, summer, winter, autumn season, and a particular season, particular vegetables are prominent, particular fruits are prominent. Expecting mango in the winter season or in the rainy season, that is not a natural thing. So similarly, our life is also, like all the relationships are seasonal. In different parts of our life, some relationships are prominent. But as the time progresses, those relationships will become, will go in the background, some other relationship will become prominent. And especially at a particular point in life, like in the towards the later part in life, like the after 50 years, 60 years, one should actually try to develop a more quality and a quality relationship with the Supreme Lord by spending time more quantitatively and also qualitatively. Because when a person is done with the different responsibilities. So therefore, this is an important principle. Many times the conflicts arise because we don't actually accept the seasonal nature of the relationships. So when we expect the relationship to have the same prominence, even though the season has changed, then that results in a conflict. So this is an important principle in a relationship. And let us see some examples from the lives of the Pandavas in relation to this topic. There is a famous story which we all know, which emphasizes this principle. Like before the Kurukshetra war, Arjun and Duryodhan, they came to meet Krishna. So Krishna was actually lying down. And Krishna said that, I will not fight in the war. I can give my Narayana Sena to somebody, but I will not fight in the war. So Duryodhan came before, and Duryodhan was waiting near Krishna's head.
And then little later Arjuna arrived, and the, at that time Krishna actually, Arjuna was standing near Krishna's feet. Krishna's feet, and then like Krishna opened his eyes little later. Like there is a, in Srirangam, one devotee was sharing that, like there's a Ranganath temple is there, and around Ranganath temple, like different streets are there in all sides. It is said that the houses which are on the side of the feet of the Ranganath Swami, those houses are costlier than the houses on the side of on the towards on the side of the head of Ranganath Swami, because they feel that this is a Duryodhan, this is a Duryodhan area, this is the Arjuna area. So they feel like that anyway. But anyway, so here then Krishna opened his eyes, and Krishna said that, Krishna asked Arjuna, because like, please tell me, what do you want? Do you want me or the Narayana Sena? Duryodhan said that, no, I came first, you should ask me. But then Krishna said, but I saw Arjuna first. So the nature of a devotee is that the devotee always wants to sit at the feet of the Supreme Lord. He doesn't want to directly, when we take the darshan of the Lord also, we are supposed to take starting from the feet, and then we are supposed to move towards the face of the Lord. But Krishna said that I have seen Arjuna first, so I will give the first opportunity to Arjuna. And Arjun said that I don't want the Narayana Sena, I want you. So here we see Arjun, without the slightest hesitation, he asked for the relationship with Krishna over the resources offered by Krishna. So one may think that it was an emotional decision. It is not a good strategy. Krishna asked Arjuna, like, why are you asking for me? I'm not going to fight for you. But Arjuna said that I need you alone, even if it meant facing challenges. Because Arjuna's understanding was that wherever there is Krishna, that itself is a victory. And everything else is a detail. So Arjuna knew that he himself was resourceful. But he needed especially the guidance and the grace of Krishna, and which was available, the proper guidance is available only from Krishna. Therefore, he gave importance to the relationship with Krishna more than the resources. So therefore, that Arjuna was enterprising in acquiring resources. He acquired many weapons also. It is not that he was very sentimental. He also acquired many weapons from different sources. But at the same time, in trying to acquire different resources, he was not stupid to give up the relationships. So Arjuna was practical in acquiring different resources. At the same time, he was prayerful. He did not compromise on his relationship with Krishna. And Duryodhan, on the other hand, he was completely senseless. He lost Krishna. He lost his own resources, and he lost his own life. So that is why we find in the Srimad Bhagavatam that here is an instance where Arjuna gave actually value to the relationship to Krishna, with Krishna, more than the resources. And the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the story of Ambarish Maharaj, when Durvasa Muni was being chased by Sudarshan Chakra. So Durvasa Muni first goes to Brahma and seeks shelter from Brahma. Brahma says that I cannot do anything. And then Durvasa Muni goes to Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva also says that I cannot protect you from the Sudarshan Chakra. And then finally he goes to Vaikuntha, he meets Vishnu. And then Vishnu also says that I cannot do anything.
But Vishnu speaks some important reasons. He says that because you have offended my devotee, and there Vishnu says that Naham Atmana Mashase Madbhaktai Sadubirvina Shriyam Chatyantikim Brahman Yesham Gatiraham Para. So Vishnu says that without the devotees for whom I am the only destination, I do not desire to enjoy the opulences of Vaikuntha. I cannot enjoy the opulences of my Vaikuntha without my devotees. Sir, Prabhupada gives such a beautiful purport. He says, how here this is a verse where Vishnu is saying that for me the relationship with my devotees are the topmost, more than the even the opulences of Vaikuntha. So therefore, that we can see that both in the example of Arjuna as well as the Supreme Lord Himself. And another point in regarding to relationship is that relationships are like a salt. Like salt, when the salt is too much in the food, then it becomes difficult to eat the food. When the salt is too less, then also it is difficult to eat the food. So similarly, sometimes when the relationships are imposing on the other person, when you try to impose or when you try to overpower on the other person, then it is like an excessive salt. That kind of relationship will not be pleasing to the others. And sometimes one is hardly involved in a relationship, one does not spend any time with the other person. Then it is like no salt only, or very less salt. So therefore, just like in building relationships is like a cooking rice. Like when you are cooking rice or when cooking any eatable, you have to put the eatable, you have to put the different dishes, either vegetable or the rice or different things, in appropriate proportion and at appropriate time. When cooking rice, after you boil the water, then you could put the rice. It's not that you put the rice in the beginning itself. You have to put at the appropriate time and also in the appropriate proportion. So similarly, that sometimes like when people try to overpower in a relationship, when they try to impose, then the relationship becomes very sore. Like for example, in the Ramayana, Kaikeyi imposed her relationship upon her husband Dashrath, which eventually caused his death. And Mantara, who was supposed to serve with humility in the house of Kaikeyi, but she imposed herself and provoked the simple Kaikeyi, and which actually led to the eventually Kaikeyi lost her credibility in the Ramayana forever. Another example is like Vali overpowered Sugriva and forced him to leave the kingdom and run away. So therefore, that like when it is overpowered, then the relationship becomes sore. On the other hand, we have the examples of the relationship between Sita and Ram, Lakshman, Sita, Ram, Lakshman and Hanuman. Like Ram never imposed this, and Sita also never demanded, and Lakshman never crossed this limit, and Hanumanji served all of them. Like in the Srimad Bhagavatam, we have the example of like Devahuti and Kardama Muni. So this is a like Devahuti and Kardama Muni, this is a story of the ideal householder life in the Bhagavatam. But just one point I wanted to highlight, that there is a description in the Srimad Bhagavatam where how Devahuti served Kardama Muni. Vishrambena Atma Shauchena. How Devahuti served Kardavamuni with reverence and also with affection in a friendly mood. Sometimes when there is only reverence, then it may become little, there is no intimacy, then it becomes only in the mood of awe and reverence. And sometimes in the mood of intimacy and friendship, one may lose the respect towards the other person. But Devahuti served Kardavamuni with reverence and also with friendship. And like she was actually daughter of Swayambhu Manu. She was a princess. But Kardavamuni was a simple Brahmana. But Devahuti got attracted to Kardavamuni by hearing about the qualities of Kardavamuni. And then Devahuti got married to Kardavamuni. And Devahuti sacrificed her previous comforts and she served Kardavamuni by actually taking up the austerities. And we see from the point of view of Kardavamuni, and Kardavamuni also satisfied Devahuti, and there is an elaborate description in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in fact, almost the entire chapter which describes that Kardavamuni, by his mystic power, he created an airship. And because a woman has a desire to see different places, and Kardavamuni, he took Devahuti to different places. He took Devahuti to so many other places where even the demigods of heavenly planets did not have opportunity to visit. Means like Kardavamuni as a husband, he also satisfied the desires of Devahuti by actually taking her to different places, and he also satisfied her desire by giving 9 daughters and one son in the form of Kapila Dev, Lord Vishnu. So we can see that when we read the description of Kardavamuni going with Devahuti to different places, it may appear like ordinary is a materialistic life. But actually, in one Bhagavatam verse, Prabhupada says that the enjoyment of Kardavamuni with Devahuti was actually glorified by even the perfected personalities. Because it was within the principles of Dharma. Within the principles of Dharma. And ultimately, they went back to Godhead in one lifetime. Kardavamuni and Devahuti, they also achieved the highest perfection in one lifetime. So we can see different examples. Devahuti sacrificed her comforts for the sake of serving Kardavamuni. And Kardavamuni took care of all the needs of Devahuti by taking her to different places, by giving her children, and then in the form of Kapila Dev, and then finally he also attained his perfection, perfection of his life. So we can see there are some points about the relationships, and therefore the difference between the Pandavas and the Kauravas. For the Pandavas, the pleasure was in meaningful relationships. And even when the Pandavas went to the forest, when they were robbed of their wealth, but they were trained to be satisfied within, even in that inconvenient situation, their greatest pleasure was in meaningful relationships with each other and while keeping Krishna in the center. On the other hand, for Duryodhan, he used the relationships for his own growth in power and facilities. But whereas the Pandavas used everything to grow in relationships. For the Pandavas, relationship was the goal, but for Duryodhan, relationship was the tool. And Duryodhan was actually, he was willing to give up a relationship if the relationship was an obstacle for his own growth. But the Pandavas were willing to give up the things that were an obstacle in the relationships. Like for example, if we see the character of the Pandavas, Draupadi
Like for every living entity, there is our eternal relationship with Krishna. And while pursuing our eternal relationship with Krishna, we also have to maintain cordial relationship with other devotees, others in the family members. If you see the character of Draupadi, like Draupadi, she exhibited her Sharanagati to Krishna in that Asat Sabha, which is the heart of Mahabharata. And after that incident, and Draupadi actually forgave her husband Yudhishthir and the other Pandavas, who did not actually come to protect her at the time of her greatest need. And Draupadi forgave them and maintained the relationship with them. So in that way, we see that Draupadi, we can see in the example of Draupadi, how she exhibited a surrender to Krishna and also how she harmonized that surrender while actually forgiving the mistakes of the other devotees, their own husbands. So that was a crime which was unforgivable, and the Pandavas also forgive Yudhishthira Maharaj's mistake. And Yudhishthira Maharaj chose to gamble. So on the other hand, Duryodhan was willing to sever his relationship with his very father and mother for not getting what he thought he should get from them. So Duryodhan would actually blackmail his own father and mother, knowing well that they are actually attached to him. So we see that this harmonizing our relationship with Krishna and also relationship with each other. We can see other examples also in the Bhagavatam. When Prachetas performed austerities and Lord Vishnu appeared, Lord Vishnu told the Prachetas, "I am very pleased with all of you because you followed the instructions of your Guru, Lord Shiva, because you chanted the song taught by Lord Shiva, and also you maintained a cordial relationship with each other, friendly relationship with each other. So therefore, I am very pleased with you." And even in the Krishna Sudama story, when Krishna and Sudama, once they went to actually get firewood, there was an intense rain and they were not able to return to the Guru's ashram in the night. They were actually staying at the top of a tree and they were holding each other in one hand. On the other hand, they were carrying the firewood. So they were actually, that firewood represents the service to the Guru. So they were doing that, they were focused on the service to the Guru. At the same time, they were actually taking care of each other by holding each other. So there is the service to the Guru and the taking care of the other God brothers, other devotees like that. So therefore, we can see like that the Pandavas, they had Krishna in the center. At the same time, they were actually taking care of each other. They forgave others' mistakes. So therefore, that in the Vedic wisdom, the relationship is a combination of freedom and discipline. Like sometimes in the modern people, they say that, there should be the relationship, there should be completely intimate, there should be complete freedom. And then, but the traditionalists, they talk about the principle of discipline and formality and respect. But if we carefully study in the Shastra, the Vedic culture, the relationship is a combination of freedom and discipline and intimacy and respect, and formality and informality, both were there. And that is what we saw in that verse, in the, how Devahuti served Kardamuni. And she served with great reverence and also with intimacy. And even Sita, when Lord Ram was hesitant to take Sita to the forest, and Sita said that, "I think my father has married me to a man from outside. It seems husband is not courageous enough to take me." Like she is somewhat provoked. So at the same time, Sita had respect towards Lord Ram.
So, and lastly, I will conclude with this point, that when Arjuna went to the heavenly planets, when he was in the actually court of Indra, Indra had arranged a Apsara dance for the pleasure of Arjuna. That time Urvashi was dancing. And Urvashi actually wanted to, Urvashi thought that Arjuna is attracted towards her, and then Urvashi wanted to actually offer herself for Arjuna's pleasure. So, but Arjuna, he was actually, he actually declined the request of Urvashi, and Arjuna was more focused on going back and getting connected with his family members. So generally, when people are more focused on efficiency, when they are, like sometimes when people are focused on efficiency and achieving certain goals in their life, and such people, they tend to like forget their relationship with others. Sometimes when they are when people are focused on achieving certain goals, say in the corporate ladder or different things, and they tend to neglect the relationship with others. But in the case of Arjuna, Arjuna was so focused in actually getting, in achieving mastery in shooting the arrows, like he would actually practice even in the night time. That was how much he was focused. And he was so focused that in that competition, he was seeing only that eye of that fish. So he was so much focused in actually in improving himself, in actually shooting the arrows, in becoming the best archer, but not at the cost of actually compromising with his relationships. Even when he went to the heaven, he acquired so many weapons, but at the same time, he was actually always remembering his relationship with his family members. So therefore, because of the relationship with the family members, like he did not get diverted by the sensuality with Urvashi. And he declined the request of Urvashi, and then he came back to the earthly planet. So therefore, Prabhupada writes in the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, when Krishna describes about the 18 points or 20 points of knowledge, the process of knowledge, one of the points he mentions is that araktir anabhisvanga putra dara grihadishu, like detachment from family, children, wealth, etc. So in this purport, Prabhupada gives a beautiful point, which is the concluding point of this class. And Prabhupada says that as for detachment from children, wife and home, it is not meant that one should have no feeling for these. They are natural objects of affection. But when they are not favorable to spiritual progress, then one should not be attracted to them. The best process for making the home pleasant is Krishna consciousness. If one is in full Krishna consciousness, he can make his home very happy, because the process of Krishna consciousness is very easy. Then he mentions that one should do these four things at home. One should chant Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So one should make it a point that the family members come together and together spend some time chanting, and one should offer the footsteps to Krishna and eat the Krishna prasadam. The second thing one should do. And third is, one should have some discussion on the books like Gita and the Bhagavatam. Well, at least they should come together at least say 10 minutes or 15 minutes, read something from Gita or Bhagavatam or Krishna book. And fourthly, and engage in deity worship at least once in a day. You offer some dhupa and deepa to the photos of the Lord, offer some flowers to the Lord. And Prabhupada says that
one should train the family members in this way. And these four things will make one happy. These four things will make one happy. If one can mold his family life in this way to develop Krishna consciousness, then there is no need to change from family life to renounce life. But if it is not congenial, then family life should be abandoned. One must sacrifice everything to realize or serve Krishna, just like Arjuna did. Arjuna did not want to kill his family members, but when he understood that the family members were impediment, then he accepted the instruction of Krishna and fought and killed them. So in this way, I just try to share some points about the topic of importance of relationships in the Dharmic culture, having Krishna in the center, based on the lives of the Pandavas and the different characters from Mahabharata and Srimad Bhagavatam. So I'll stop here. If anybody has any one question, I will take. Otherwise, I'll end the class.
Thank you for the nice class. What you said about relationships and happiness, but I agree with it properly. But in the there is an index called as happiness index worldwide, it is available. But the rate, the Asian part, the Eastern part, very at the low level. Whereas this happiness index, they rate the Western world at the very higher level. This is true contrary what basically what we think of. So any views on that?
No, it's all many times it becomes all these surveys are a little superficial, and then many times they are all propagated by certain people with a power. Because they want to project, oh, these are all underdeveloped countries. And they want to promote certain industrialization, westernization in certain countries. Sometimes they project like that. Like Prabhupada says in a purport that the advancement of a civilization is determined based on five things. Is determined based on how these five people are taken care of. Old people, children, women, brahmanas, and the cows. Like this is the criteria by which whether the civilization is advanced or not. It's dependent on whether how these five people are happy, how these five people are taken care of. Because children, they will become the future leaders, they will become the future generation. The women, they play a very crucial role because they are the moral guardians of the society. When a woman is properly situated, then the whole family is benefited. Because she gives inspiration to the children and the husband. And the brahmanas, they play a crucial role in educating the people. And the cows, they give a miracle food in the form of the milk. Cows are the source of prosperity, like that. So therefore, these like happiness index, like many times we have to see like how do they measure that? We cannot take in a literal sense. So I'll stop here. Thank you for your patient attention. Grantara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Gaura Bhakta Vrinda ki jai.
Hare Krishna. So thank you, Radhika Vallabh Prabhu, for giving such an enlightening talk on harmonizing our